Hello students, today we are going to start with unit 3 prose named Fur by author Saki. Let's know something about the author first. Hector Hugh Munro, better known by his pseudonym Saki, was a British writer whose humorous and sometimes macabre stories satirized Edwardian society and culture. Now first thing, your pseudonym here means a fictitious name used by a person who performs a social role. Now, many celebrities we all know who don't use or who don't want people to know their actual name. So, they use fictitious or you can say fake names. So, same here, author Hector Hugh Munro, he also used fake name Saki for the people or the readers to know about him. He was a British writer who had written many humorous and sometimes macabre stories. Macabre here means very unpleasant or frightening stories, because they are connected with death. People don't like to read it, or it horrifies them. They feel very bad when they read it. So he was mainly famous for such kind of stories, both humorous as well as macabre stories. And these stories mainly satirize Edwardian society. Edwardian society means it is an era when King Edward VII was ruling Britain here. He was the eldest son of Queen Victoria. So his stories mainly satirize Edwardian society. He is considered to be the master of short story genre. Means he mainly had written short stories. Munro was born in Burma when it was still a part of British Empire. He served in the Indian Imperial Police before beginning a career as a journalist. Means he had worked in a police force when British were ruling our country. And after leaving that particular field, he became a journalist. His first work, the only book published under his own name, was a historical study, The Rise of Russian Empire. Means he had written a book under his own name. The title of that book was The Rise of Russian Empire. Munro's stories feature brilliant comic characterization, light, polished, witty dialogue, and finely judged narratives. Means it has the readers could find very deep insight into his writings. In addition to his short stories, which were first published in newspapers and later collected in several volumes, he also wrote a few novels and one-act plays as well as full-length plays. The Watched Pot, in collaboration with Charles Mott, Munro served in the British Army during the First World War and died in action in France. Means he had served into British Army, he has served British Army during First World War, and he died when they had a war with France. Now about the story here. Now children, this is also very important, because when you write your answer about, suppose the question is related to this particular prose, so if you are writing the answer first in 3 to 4 lines, you can just give introduction about the author and then start the answer. So to know about the author is also very important. After that, about the text. This is a typical Saki story, full of sly humor and penetrating insight into human foibles and characters. Means here, in as we all know, we have seen in the earlier paragraph, his stories had humor as well as very horrifying, you can say, scenes and all, which would make the readers think, have deep insight into what he wanted to say through his stories. And it were related, you can say, to human weaknesses, and also about to know about deep insight into the character. It takes a seemingly innocuous event, what to ask for a birthday gift, and turns into a fascinating window into the nature of the ego and human interaction. Means here this story is just about an event where it is you can say a very light incident had first occurred, that two friends are there here in this story named Eleanor and Suzanne. This one of the friend named Suzanne, she wanted one of her cousin to give her a birthday gift. So how this particular situation, she asked for a suggestion from a friend and she wanted her friend Eleanor to help her in this matter, we'll come to know in detail in the story here. But suddenly just this light event, how it turned into you can say ego, revenge and all, we'll come to know in the story. So let's start with the story here. "You look worried, dear," said Eleanor. "I am worried," admitted Suzanne. This Eleanor and Suzanne, they both are friends. So here, this when she comes to meet Suzanne, she asks her that you look worried. So she's saying, yes, I am worried. Not worried exactly, but anxious. Here Suzanne is saying that I am not worried exactly, but I am very anxious, means I am very nervous. "You see, my birthday happens next week." She's saying my birthday is next week. "You lucky person," interrupted Eleanor. "My birthday doesn't come till the end of March." She's saying that you are very lucky that in the next week only your birthday is there. But it's a very long time for my birthday now, because it will come after the end of March. "Well, old Bertram Kent is over in England just now from the Argentine. He is a kind of distant cousin of my mother's and so enormously rich that we would never let the relationship drop out of the sight." Here, Suzanne is saying that one of my mother's cousin, distant cousin named Bertram, he is in England now. He has come from Argentine and he is very rich. So though he is a distant cousin, we don't fail to let have connection with him or to know about his well-being, to be in relation with him, because he is very rich. "Even if we don't see him or hear from him for years, he is always cousin Bertram when he does turn up." Means she's saying that even though for years we don't see him or we don't hear from him, he doesn't call up us or we don't call up him, but still he is a very close cousin for us. "I can't say he's ever been of much solid use to us, but yesterday the subject of my birthday cropped up and he asked me to let him know what I wanted for a present." Now here's this girl, Suzanne, is saying that I didn't know that he can be such useful to us, but suddenly yesterday when he came to our house, it might be that time, what happened, he just asked me, we were just having a normal discussion that time, the discussion of Suzanne's birthday cropped up and he asked her to let him know what she wanted as a birthday gift. "Now I understand the anxiety," observed Eleanor. So Eleanor is saying, "Now I come to know why are you so anxious or nervous." "As a rule, when one is confronted with a problem like that," said Suzanne, "all of one's ideas vanish. One doesn't seem to have a desire in the world." Means she is saying that it is usual, every time it happens, that if anyone is having this situation where they have to give someone one option, so they are very confused what to tell and what not to say. They are very confused, they don't understand what conclusion they can come up to. So same thing is happening here. Now Bertram has asked Suzanne to tell her what she wants as a birthday gift, but this girl is not able to decide. She is not able to come to conclusion that what she should tell him. "Now, it so happens that I have been very keen on a little Dresden figure." Dresden figure means what? Small, women figure or models made up of clay, China clay. She's saying that I have been very keen, means she is very interested in one of such, models that she had seen in Kensington. and it cost about 36 shillings, quite beyond my means. Means she is not, it is not affordable for her to buy such expensive model ear. I was very nearly describing the figure and giving Bertram the address of the shop, and then it suddenly struck me that 36 shillings was such a ridiculously inadequate sum for a man of his immense wealth to spend on a birthday present. Means she was, she said to her friend, she's saying to her friend that I really like that particular model there, or you can say clay model there, so that I was about to tell Bertram about the address of the shop, and I wanted to tell him how nice it that model looked and all, but suddenly I felt that he is such a rich man, it would be not correct to tell him to buy just this 36 shillings model here. He could give her a more expensive gift. I could buy a bunch of violets, and she's saying that if he gives her some amount, then she could buy a bunch of violets. And she's saying further that I don't want to be greedy, of course, but I don't like being wasteful. I mean, she's saying I'm not greedy here, I'm not asking for more here, but I don't want to be wasteful. Means if a person can give her more expensive gifts, then why to ask the cheaper one, according to her. The question is, said Eleanor, what are his ideas as to present giving? Now the friend Eleanor, she's asking Suzanne that according to you, what are his ideas as to present giving? Because some of the wealthiest people have curiously cramped views on that subject. When people grow gradually rich, their requirements and standard of living expand in proportion, while their present giving instincts often remain in the undeveloped condition of their earlier days. Means according to Eleanor, some people, though they become rich here, but while giving gift to others, sometimes what happens, they just try, they just want to give a cheaper gift. They don't want to give very expensive or costly gifts. Something showy, not too expensive in a shop is their only conception of the ideal gift. And the, those people, they all want to give not very expensive, you can say a cheaper gift, but it should be very, you can say, showy one, attractive one. That is why even quite good shops have their counters and windows crowded with things worth about 4 shillings that look as if they might be 7 and 6 and are priced 10 shillings and labeled seasonable gifts. Means here she is saying that for the same reason you can find in many counters or many shops, you can find they are crowded where they just are giving things of for four shillings, which look like they are very attractive, and they look like 7 and 6, and they use mainly they are priced on the packet like 10 shillings. I mean, just to make people feel that yeah, it is very expensive, but actually they are not. I know, said Suzanne, that is why it is so risky to be vague when one is giving indication of one wants. Means she's saying that is the same reason why I am getting so confused here to tell the person what I actually want. Now, if I say to him I am going out to Davos this winter, Davos is a holiday spot in Switzerland, so anything in the traveling line would be acceptable. Means she's saying that if I tell Bertram that I am going to Davos there to spend a holiday and all, so he might give me something related to my traveling tour and all. He might give me a dressing bag with a gold mounted fittings. But on the other hand, he might give me Baedeker Switzerland or skiing without tears or something of that sort. Means she's saying he might give me something related to traveling, like a dressing bag or traveling guide or skiing without tears, something like that he can give me if I tell him that I am going for a holiday. He would be more likely to say she'll be going to lots of dances, a fan will be sure to be useful. Means here she is confused. He can give him a bag or a, you can say a guidebook, or you can say anything other thing, but he can also give her just a fan, thinking that there she will be attending many dances, so she might need a fan there. Yes, I have got tons of fans. So you see where the danger and anxiety lies, and she's saying that I have got so many fans which she can use to while dancing. So she is saying that that's why I am very confused that what to ask him. Now, if there is one thing more than another that I really urgently want, it is first. Means he's saying, this girl, Susan, is saying that if I hear the thing which I really desire here is fur. She wanted a fur dress or jacket, you can say, which she wanted to wear. I simply haven't any. She's saying I don't have, and so that's why I want a dress or jacket as a gift from him, which is of fur. I am told that Davos is full of Russians and they are sure to wear most lovely sables and things. Here means sables means what? Black garment worn in mourning and things. To be among people who are smothered in furs when one hasn't any oneself makes one want to break most of the commandments. Smothered means what? Suffocated means these people, this Russian, the people who are in Davos, they mainly wear jackets or dresses of fur. So she's saying if I go there and if I'm not having any dress or jacket of fur, it won't be correct. It won't look nice. I also want to look same as they look there when I am there in Davos. If it's furs, then you are out for, said Eleanor. You will have to superintend the choice of them in person. You can't be sure that your cousin knows the difference between silver fox and ordinary squirrel. Means she's saying that if you want a dress or jacket with fur and with fur jacket or dress here, then you have to be very correct in making a choice, because your cousin should know the difference between silver fox and ordinary squirrel. Means the difference between the material here, which you can say is good, which is good and which is not. There are some heavenly silver fox stoles at Goliath and Mastodon's, said Susan with a sigh. So here she's saying that I can get a good fur dress or jacket from Goliath or Mastodon's. If I could only envision Bertram into their building and take him for a stroll through the fur department. Means in envision here means what? To just may encourage someone by flattery that will go have a walk there, and suddenly she will show him that see, this is fur shop. And if they go inside the shop, then she will say that I like this jacket or a dress, and he would buy for her as a birthday gift. She had this kind of plan in her mind. He lives somewhere near there, doesn't he? Said Eleanor. So her friend Eleanor is saying he lives nearby there only, no? Do you know what his habits are? Does he take a walk at any particular time of the day? Now this girl, Eleanor, she wanted to help her friend to get a fur jacket from Bertram. So that's why she is helping her out, and she is telling her that do you know what are his habits, what he does throughout the day, does time of the day when he goes for a walk, do you know or not? That's in such type of question she is asking to Susan. He usually walks down to his club about 3 o'clock. If it's a fine day, that takes him right past Goliath and Mastodon. I mean, she is saying that he goes to his club at 3 o'clock, and if it's a fine day, if it's a fine sunny day and all, he goes walking, and he goes from this same shop where you can get fur like Goliath and Mastodon's. Let us two meet him accidentally at the street corner tomorrow, said Eleanor. So now Eleanor, she really wanted to help Susan. So she's saying what we'll do, we'll make a plan. We both will accidentally meet him there at the street corner. We can walk a little way with him. We'll just have a walk with him. And with luck, we ought to be able to sidetrack him into shop. And she's saying while talking, just having a chat with him, we can suddenly take him to the shop there. you can say you want to get a hairnet or something. You can just say that I want to get a hairnet or something. When we are safely there, I can say, I wish you would tell me what you want for a birthday gift. Now, very smartly, Anya is telling that when we take this man into the shop, then I will pretend. I will just try to tell you like that, that I wish I would give you gift which you really desire, which you really want. Then you will tell her, you will have everything ready to hand. Means she's saying when he becomes to know that you want a fur jacket, when I ask you and you reply that yes, I want a fur jacket, then this rich cousin will buy it for you as a birthday gift, because he has told first only that he wants Susan to tell her what she wants as a birthday gift. It's a great idea, said Susan. So Susan is saying it's a great idea, we can do it. You really are a brick, means you are really a genius. Come round tomorrow at 2:40. Don't be late. We must carry out our ambush to the minute. Means she's saying we will carry out this very, you can say, master plan tomorrow there. So come on time. At a few minutes to three the next afternoon, the fur trappers walked warily, means very cautiously, they reached to their destination there, towards the selected corner. In the near distance rose the colossal pile of Messrs. Gollier and Masterton's front establishment, that building, extremely large building. The afternoon was brilliantly fine, exactly the sort of weather to tempt a gentleman of advancing years into the discreet exercise of a leisurely walk. Means it was a fine day and it was really nice weather, so they could tell this man to just come on, we can go for a walk. He could also feel tempting that it is a nice day, so he can go for a walk there. I say, dear, I wish you would do something for me this evening, said Elinor to her companion. Now we come to know that Elinor is really trying to help her friend Susan to get a desired birthday gift from her cousin named Bertman. But here, now in from this paragraph, children, you will come to know, now Elinor also needs Susan's help. Now see what kind of help Elinor wants. I say, dear, I wish you would do something for me this evening, said Elinor to her companion, which she said to Susan. Just drop in after dinner on some pretext or other and stay on to make a fourth at bridge with Adela and the aunts. Now she's saying my cousin Adela and my aunts, they are playing a bridge. Bridge is a game of cards in which four persons are required. So she's saying my aunts and Adela are playing this game. A fourth person is required here and I can't go there because I will be with Bertman, means that cousin, so that I could make him buy a fur gift for you. So I could not make for this game here, bridge game. So on my behalf, you just go and play this game with my cousin and aunts, she is telling to Susan. Otherwise, I shall have to play. She is saying, if you don't go, I will have to play. And Scarisbrook is going to come in unexpectedly about 9:15. And I particularly want to be free to talk to him while others are playing. Now she's saying, I really want your help. I want you to play there. Sorry, my dear, no can do, said Susan. But here, this friend, Susan, she is very selfish girl. She is not ready to help Elinor. She's saying, no, sorry, I can't help you. Ordinary bridge at 3 pence a hundred with such dreadfully slow players as your aunts bores me to tears. I nearly go to sleep over it. She's saying, no, I cannot play with your aunts and all. They are very boring and I will feel sleepy if I go to play with them. So I will not help you with this case. I cannot help you, she's saying. But I most particularly want an opportunity to talk with Harry, urged Elinor, an angry glint coming into her eyes. She's saying, I really want time to talk with Harry, because if I don't, if I play, then I won't get time to talk to him. So please help me out. And she is very angry because this Susan is not helping her out. Sorry, anything to oblige, but not that, says Susan cheerfully. Means Susan is not at all bothered that her friend is needing her here. She wants her help. She is very selfish girl and she is saying, no, no, sorry, I cannot help you. The sacrifices of friendship were beautiful in her eyes as long as she was not asked to make them. Means she really pretended that she is really a true friend of Elinor and she can help her whenever she is in need. But now when she Elinor is actually asking her for help, she is not ready to help her. Elinor said nothing further on the subject, but the corner of her mouth rearranged themselves. When she became very sad that see how I am trying to help her to get a desired birthday gift from her cousin. But this girl, when I am asking her for the help, she is not ready to help me. So she is very upset with Susan now. There's our man, exclaimed Susan suddenly. Hurry, means suddenly she sees birthman coming there, walking there. So she is saying that, see, there is our man. See, he is standing there. So let's go, she is telling to Elinor. Mr. Birthman Kington greeted his cousin and her friend with genuine heartiness and readily accepted their invitation to explore the crowded mart that stood temptingly at their elbow. The plate glass door swung open, the trio plunged bravely into the jostling throng of buyers and loiterers. Means they just greeted him, they, you can say, greeted each other. And after that, oh, they just told that person, can we go for a walk into this mall or shop, something like that. And he readily accepted their invitation and they all were just loitering joyfully into those near the shops and on. It is always as full as this, asked Bertram to Elinor. Means Elinor, Bertram, the cousin is asking to Elinor, Susan's friend, Elinor he is asking. That it is so crowded, it is always full like this only, or what? He is just asking her.